Sahano Vunaktu Sahaviyam Karavahai Tejasvina Vadhitamastu Mavitvishavahai Om Shanti Shanti Samasta Janakalyani Niratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Sadgurum Brahmavidvaram Om Sri Chinna Sadguru Vedana. We are in the last two mantras of Kathopnishad, and we have seen what happens to the sadhaka who has reached the crescendo. We have tried to see what are the physiopsychological changes that happen in the shariram of the sadhaka. And we have tried to see the glimpse of an overview of Kundalini and the Shad Chakras or Sapta Chakras. The one who has realized Atman, his journey is the travelogue of Nachiketa. From the ordinary and so-called mundane world, the reason why the world is called ordinary and mundane is because we consider it important and relevant. Yogis consider that as ordinary and mundane. It is the same world, the interpretations are different. The organs of perception called Indriya, the organ of cognition called Antakkarana, they are used in a mutated manner when we interact with the world. And the day, with the grace of Lord, the grace of Guru, and the grace of our Shuddha Parabdha Karma or Sattva Karma, a day dawns in our life when we realize that the way I am treating this world as extremely relevant, and I being a part separate from the world, when this idea dies down or tries to dwindle in its importance, that is the time when the journey of sadhaka starts. The person who wants to inculcate good habits in him takes the first decision that he has to leave the brothel or the pub, both being the places where he cannot progress, or he is not destined to be at those places. So the first awareness of the realization that I am at the wrong place is the first point of the beginning of journey, and a very vital point. Many factors play their own role in making us aware or realize that we are in the wrong place, or we are interpreting the world in the wrong manner. But once that happens, then one is sure what to leave. One may not be sure where to go. Once we are sure what to leave, then the journey starts. And in this journey, it is also called antar pravas or internal journey. From the bahya vishwa, we start moving towards antar vishwa. In this antar vishwa, we realize that the vastness of the world, the way I have interpreted, needs to be discarded completely, and the immediate task is to know what is my internal world is all about. And after knowing the internal world and myself, as nothing else but the Atman itself. I re-enter into the world, but now with a renewed vigor and a completely changed perspective or a new vision. So you leave the world, start the journey, end at the destination, and re-enter into the world, but in a different manner. That is how the journey is said to be concluded. In the last class, we saw that as the purity of the sadhaka starts moving up, changes start coming in him as well as in his body. And when we say body, we are referring to all the different shariras, not only one sharira. Sthula sharira, of course, undergoes transformation. Last time we saw a glimpse of how the Hiranya Kanti, or the golden hue, comes to the physical self, or the sthula sharira. But those are minor changes. The major changes are the internal clock of the body, the milieu of the body, not in the physiological sense, but in the psychological sense, also starts changing. The attitude changes, the vision changes, the enormous width, depth of the intellect starts changing, and the person starts undergoing transformation. These changes come to him involuntarily as he progresses on the path. As he starts realizing his inner structure, the outer structure automatically gets revealed to him. So although the journey is inwards, the universe starts throwing the secrets open to him. And this opening of universal secrets is also called Siddhis. We saw the Siddhis while seeing the Hanuman Chalisa. So the Navanidhi and the Sapta Siddhi, they automatically start opening up for the sadhaka. Once the sadhaka has moved forward from here, then he reaches a stage where, as Gurudeva calls, and I again repeat many a times, in the intense heat of meditation. Meditation is an exclusive approach to something that has not been intuitively perceived so far. How do you withdraw from the world? The withdrawal from the world in physical sense is perhaps a little easy, which is nothing else but the solitude. But the withdrawal from the world is to withdraw the world from the mind. Removing physically the body from the world is something which many people can attempt and succeed, which we call solitude. But removing the mind from the world is the most difficult thing to do, because the mind does not exist in the world. The world exists in the mind. If the world exists in the mind, then to withdraw the mind from the world would mean challenging the basic nature of the mind, which is nothing else but the vagary, chanchalata. Mind will not be called a mind if it does not shift and flicker from place to place, from person to person, from idea to idea, from memory to memory, and that is the nature of the mind. Taming the mind or controlling the mind is the essence of meditation. So when one who has absolved himself from the external world to the minimum possible, and whatever he is doing externally in the world by thoughts, deeds and action is pure. You have no enmity with anyone. We have no vested selfish interest in anything that you do in your life. Then everything that you do is for the welfare of the others. Unselfishness means every breath that you take is for others. less you think of yourself, lesser you think of harming anyone, your ego or the self starts dwindling down, and any act done without selfishness is the act of punyam, or the right deed, or the dharmic deed. Thus, by upholding the dharma, you purify yourself in body, speech, and action. Tan, man, dhan. Once we do this, then and then only the person can further start looking inwards at the final frontier, which works through an important station called mind. At this station called mind, with the purity that is so far achieved, it helps us in taming down the mind and its vagaries. Chitta kshubdhata can now be thought of bringing under control. Once the mind starts coming under control, then it cannot be asked to stop its function, because the moment you stop its function, it is no more alive, it is dead. And it is very difficult to kill the mind, or as Gurudeva says, it's difficult to commit suicide of the mind. The only way the mind can be made to die is by making it or keeping it emaciated, hungry, not feeding him what it requires. And mind thrives on thinking. Thought is mind's food. The food that the mind obtains is either from the external world, which is the world of objects, nama rupa atmaka, or the memory, smriti. If one can stop the supply of food to the mind, mind slowly starts getting emaciated. Such an emaciated mind then only survives on the breath. That means only one idea, only one sankalpana. So, as the mind starts reducing its application in this world, one by one, it slowly starts settling down, and it gets exhausted of its vagaries, and it stops its action of moving from place to place, and thus the chitta shubdhata comes down. When this has happened, and the sadhaka, who now can be referred as a yogi, has become expert in focusing his mind on one object, he has entered the territory of what is called meditation. Meditation is exclusive application of mind on one exclusive thought or object, and then the amount of time that the mind can keep itself focused on this object, as it starts increasing, the mind and its entire power accumulates at this focused point, and then the focused point becomes the entire activity of mind, and then the mind becomes avrutta with that particular concept or object or thought, and it takes the shape of that thought or an object, and that is when the meditation starts becoming successful. During the process of meditation, the one who is meditating, that means the mind of the one who is meditating, since it is focusing on that one singular object, it slowly transforms itself from his own place of existence to the place of the object that is meditated upon. In this process, initially the mind is occupying 90% of the role, or 95% of the role, saying that 5% is allocated or attributed to the object of meditation, that which is meditated upon. As time passes by, the mind starts getting absorbed in the object of meditation, and the percentage of loss of mind into the object keeps on increasing. As this percentage moves forward and becomes more and more, less of mind remains, more of object is there. Imagine a situation when the whole world is absent, only the mind and the object of meditation are into the picture, the antakkarana and the dhyanamurti or dhyana object. And such dhyanam object slowly is overtaking the mind, then what remains in this world, in the inner world of this yogi or the sadhaka, is the object itself in the form that it is contemplated upon. And that is when it is said that the object becomes druggochara. In other words, the entire antakarana perceives only the object. And in such a case, if the object happens to be Narayana or the Vishnu, Shaligrama, then he himself appears in front of us, because the mind has pervaded the object to an extent that the object has overtaken the mind with a small percentage or a minuscule thread of mind called Sukshma Antakaran Bhakti witnessing this particular act. When this happens, when the thin thread of mind or Antakaran is watching a massive occupied space by the object of meditation, it is called Sa Vikalpa Samadhi. This is penultimate culmination of the meditation, not the ultimate. The yogi doesn't get deterred even at this point. Stressing himself further, when he moves forward, then the last thread of witnessing mind or the Sukshma Antakarana Vritti also vanishes. And what remains is the meditated object alone, even without an iota of proof that there is somebody watching it. So when the witness is lost, then the meditation reaches the culmination, because the mediator and the object that has been meditated upon become one. That is called the Triputilaya, and that is Nirvikalpa Samadhi. When that happens, at that point of time, there is something that pervades everything, and that is the intuitive knowledge of meditation, which is the one who intuitively perceives the Atma Tattvam. It is not knowing, it is not witnessing, it is feeling. Jnatavya. To know. Know without the process of knowing. Knowing is vritti jnana. Knowledge of Atma Jnanam is jnana. It is not attributed by anything as knowledge of mind, knowledge of object, knowledge of indriya. No, it is pure knowledge. Sat, chit, ananda. Sat, because astitva is felt. Chit, because you are aware of it. And the awareness is choiceless awareness. Swasamvedya. Self-knowing. I know myself. Even the know myself drops down. I remains. Is Sat is I. I am is the Chit. And the Sthiti is a completely different Sthiti which cannot be described, because it is beyond Sukham and Dukham. And since there is no word for Sukham and Dukham beyond that, it is called Anandam. Anandam is unique in its nature because it has no opposite. Dukham is not the opposite of Ananda. Sukham and Dukham is in the Vritti Jnanam, in the mortal world. In the immortal world, it is nothing else but the soul existing as soul, perceiving soul as soul. Atma is perceived, that is why we say Brahmavid Brahmeva Bhavati. The knower of Brahman becomes Brahman alone or itself. And when that happens, the journey concludes. The journey concludes because there is nothing beyond that as a station. Now when such a person, enlightened yogi, comes back into the mortal world, if he is a Jivan Mukta, his attitude, his vision of the entire world is completely different. He even goes to the extent of saying that, look, all that you see hasn't existed at all, is not existing at all. It is a standpoint. The person who is in the water feels that there is water everywhere. The one who is looking from the banks, he says that no, water is different. You feel you are in the water, but that is part of the land on which this pond is situated. So the erroneous impression of the world that a normal or ordinary person has changes into the enlightened vision of the world. The purpose of the creation of the world is fully understood by a yogi simply because he becomes the one who created the world. By going into the shoes of the one who created it, the Ishvara, the attitude towards the world becomes the attitude of Ishvara itself towards the world, which is nothing else but the compassionate mother, the compassionate mother of creation. And that is why such an enlightened person becomes a source of not only the happiness, but he becomes a savior of the mankind, the way Gurudeva was. This is the place where Gurudeva was residing. Any kind of appreciation of Gurudeva from the ordinary mortal world, saying that he was sympathetic, he was soft-spoken, these are all attributes of ordinary world. He was in the realm of extraordinary world, paralaukika, not even paralaukika, alaukika vishwa he was. And from there he operated, we heard the spandanam or the reverberations of what Gurudeva said. So once we know the state of Gurudeva, the last mantra, the 17th mantra of the last valli, the Shastra valli, or Tritiya valli of the second adhyaya of Kathopanishad, the Upanishad says that one who concentrates on this antaratma, presuming that atman lying at the level of a place near the heart, Rudguha, in the form of Angushta Matra. His presence is felt in the body for the meditator in the form of a flame which is of the size of a thumb. Angushta Matra Purushaha Antaratmaha. This doesn't mean that Atma is of the shape of a thumb or it is in the form of a flame. It is not so. As Gurudeva said, since a prop is required for the meditation, such a prop is taken by the meditator, and that prop being now not in the form of any murti or any dev or any bhagwan, the prop now is direct interpretation of Atman in the form of Angushta Matra Jyoti called Purusha of Sankhya, which is itself nothing else but the Brahman, which is supposed to be residing into the heart near the Rudguha. Even it has been interpreted in Shadchakras Nirupana or Kubjika Tantra, the Tantra that gave us all the details about the Kundalini Mata. So such a description tells us that this Angushta Matra Purusha is lying at the Anahata Chakra. We have seen last time the chakra starting from Muladhara. Then we have Swadhisthana, Manipura, and then Anahata near the heart. The Anahata Chakra is the one where Vayu is the presiding deity. One whose Kundalini has reached to Anahata Chakra, he becomes the controller of the Vayu, Vayu being the precursor of the second important Panchamahabhuta, he comes to control the entire world. That is why Pavanasuta Hanuman, we saw that. He is the controller there. At the Anahata Chakra, which is at the heart level, at the Radguha, which is even described as something which is on the right side, not the left side. The physiological heart is on the left side. It is under Dakshina, the right side. It is supposed to be a flame. Something that cannot be dissected, something that cannot be seen. But one who contemplates on that, Angushta Matra Purushaha Antaratma, Sada Jananam Hridaye Sannivishthe, Sada Jananam, always in everybody's heart, Hridguha, this Angushta Matra Purusha means Chaitanya Tattvam in the form of a flame, Angushta Matra in the form and shape of the thumb, is always residing. One who is able to reach through the meditation to this, Tam Swacharidat Pravruhet Munjadi Veshikam Dhairiyena Munjadi Veshikam. We have this rice paddy. When the paddy is there, we know how the husk is removed from the paddy and the reed or the rush grass. When we remove that rice from the paddy, it is done very slowly without disturbing the rice, only the husk is taken away. We are not supposed to break the rice or make it into multiple pieces. And that is why this operation of removing the rice from the husk or the paddy is a very smooth and easy operation. In the similar manner, from these different types of koshas or shariras, the Atman is removed so smoothly. And once that is removed, in other words, the moment you come to know that the Prakruti and the Purusha are different, Shariram and the Atman is different, that itself is Atma Darshanam. If one is able to do that, Swat Sharirat in Pravruhet, Pravruhet is Bruhi. Pravruhet is to slowly remove. In fact, rice is also called Vruhi in Sanskrit. Vruhi because it is slowly removed from the husk and the rice is taken out. Similarly, from your body, if you are able to, from your shariram, if you are able to take the Atman out, then Tam Vidya Shukramam Amrutam. Then he gets what is called as pure and immortal. He is known and knows him as pure and immortal. Yes, know him as pure and immortal. There is a dvirukti, two times the last line has come in the mantra. It is a common dictum that whenever the last line is repeated, that is the end of the grantha. Since Kathopanishad has come to the conclusion, Tam Vidyam Shukram Amrutam, Tam Vidyam Shukram Amrutam Iti. Now the mantra tells us that the Kathopanishad has come to an end. And here, giving the comment on this mantra, Swamiji has very clearly said, seekers with a prop for their mind at meditation to concentrate upon, that is the reason size and shape has been given to facilitate our meditation during the earlier stage of path of dhyana. This earlier stage word by Gurudeva warrants our attention. Why it warrants our attention? Because meditation may start from pratika. Pratika could be a murti that we are aware of or a god that we are aware of. It can also start from something which is not a saguna but some akara, saguna sakara. So when you say a flame, it has an akara but no gunam. To that extent, maybe prakasham is a gunam. Then we go to nirgun nirakara, something, a kind of a void. We feel there is nothing and yet you can concentrate. That means don't bring anything to the mind. And that nothing coming to the mind is to be concentrated upon. It is called asambhuta upasana. And then comes aham graha upasana also, wherein you consider yourself as the God. Aham graha. Main Vishnu hu. I am the Vishnu. This is also the way of moving in the meditation forward. So I am the Atman is the way of meditating, which is the later stage of meditation. So you go from a prop to the propless situation in meditation. Nachiketa and through Nachiketa, the entire world of seeker is advised to extricate the element of absolute consciousness, the pure chit essence from the dilutory consciousness of the body by continuous and deep practice of discrimination in meditation. That is what Gurudeva says. But most important part Gurudeva says is that during the meditation, one should not in the least strain oneself, is so vividly brought out by the analogy of drawing out the pith from the reed. What it means is the meditation is a smooth gliding affair. We cannot just one day sit and somehow try to see that Atma Darshan Lunga Ya To Uthunga Nahi. This is not how it goes. It is a process. It is a smoother process. It is a process done under Guru's guidance, because we, with the buddhi that we have, however powerful it may be, we are at the mercy of supramental activity. And a supramental activity can only be guided by one who has reached the supramental state, the Guru. So when something is transcending the intellect, we should not try and struggle with the intellect. That is what it is also indicating. So a deliberate attempt whereby the body, that's why we see there are many people who try to exercise undue force on their body, on their mind, to achieve the Atma Tattvam, which should not and need not be the case. So once you come to know that you are the one who are immortal, and he is immortal as such as he is the eternal unborn truth, that is where the mantra is also explained in this manner by Shankaracharya. He says, Angushta Matraha Purushaha Antaratma Sada Jananam Sambandini Rudaye Sannivishte. The same first line of this mantra, we find the echo of the same line in Bhagavad Gita also. Sarvasya Aham Radhisim Nivishte Smuti Jnanor Apohanam Cha. This mantra is again saying the same thing. So, I am staying in the heart of my devotees. Hey Arjuna, when the Lord says, he is talking about the same thing, which is Angushta Matra Purusha. Then he says, once we reach this stage where we are able to slowly extricate, when we remove this particular husk from the rice, a moment comes when what happens? The husk remains in the hand and the rice frees itself and just falls out in the same manner. That is the moment of self-realization. This is the moment which is described when we read about Gautama Buddha, that he was sitting under the sal tree, and then early in the morning in Vaishakha Purnima, he got the enlightenment. The reference of enlightenment is nothing else but this moment of truth. Moment of truth, because this is the time when the Atma Tattvam is perceived, that is also not a right word, known, that is also not a right word, but intuitively understood that I am nothing else but the I am Atma Brahman. The Mahavakyam becomes true here. And that is why this particular mantra ends with the aim that was achieved by Nachiketa. Yama Dharma has prokta, he has said in so many dialectical discussions to the Nachiketa how this Atma Tattvam is to be achieved. Needless to say, Nachiketa, the brightest student that one can get, has achieved this particular state. And that is why at this stage, Vidya Stutyartho Ayam Akhyayikartho Upasamvaro Aduna Uchyate. Now, because that whole Akhyayika, the episode, the Kathopanishad is ending, Jnana Stuti Prityartham, now it is said, and then the last mantra comes. The last mantra is Phalashruti. Why do you read Kathopanishad? What is the Phalam? In every grantha, there is a phalam. And the phalam is here mentioned, and this is where our focus should be. And what is the phalam? Mrutyu prokta nachiketo athalabdhva vidyam etam yogi vidhim cha kutsnam brahma prapto virajo abhut vimrutyuhu anya api evam yahavit adhyatmam eva. What it means is, Nachiketa, Mrityu Prokta, having been told by Mrityu, Yamadharma himself, as instructed by Lord of Death in this knowledge, Labdhva, he obtained. Although it is not something to be obtained, Labdhva is attained, not obtained. Labdhva is having attained. Gurudeva has given the translation as attained. Attained means you reach a stage. When you reach a stage, you don't obtain it. The state is already existing. You move from paristhiti to sthiti. So in that, vidyam etam yoga vidhim cha, this is the whole process is called yoga. This is yoga. In the whole process of yoga, you become free from all impurities. Brahma prapto viraja abhut vimrutyuhu. You attain Brahman. And because of what happens? There is no raja. Raja means dirt. Rajoguna. Raja means dirt. Viraja. Vigata rajaha. That means dirt is gone. That is why we all know that whenever you take a sannyas, there is a home which is called viraja home. All the sannyasis do viraja home. That means they take a vow that no dirt, and dirt means not the dirt of kind which we face. Dirt means dirt of the world itself. Not being into the world. That is why samni as iti sannyasaha. In a sannyasi, completely absolves himself from all kind of worldly interactions, which is raja. So such a Brahma prapto is a viraja, and he is abhuta. He becomes abhuta. He becomes what? He becomes amrutam vimrutyuhu. He becomes amar. He becomes abhuta means abhavat. He becomes amrutyuhu. He becomes more immortal. Now the last line of the mantra is the most critical line for us. Anya api eva yaha. Anyone else also means includes us. Anya api evam yaha with adhyatmam eva. That means the one, even anyone else, if he is keen on knowing the inner self, adhyatma, inner self, then he also can become Nachiketa, or he also can become Amrutatva Praptam, or he can become Atmadnya, one who knows, one who is Atmibhuta, Brahmibhuta. And that is the essence or the phalam of the entire Kathopanishad. At this stage, iti Kathaka Upanishad Dvitiya Adhyaya Shashte Vallihi. This finishes the sixth valli of the Dvitiya Adhyaya of the Kathaka Upanishad with the grace of the Rushi called Kathaka Rushi from the Yajurveda Samhita. We are able to get this Guhyataram Jnanam on the platter, freely distributable for the humanity, as the final solution. Day in and day out, we are struggling to fight a final solution to our problems. We are prepared to pay enormous amount of wealth that we have created, and yet without even paying an iota of the so-called worldly wealth, Vedas are throwing open through the Upanishadas, and one such jewel of the Upanishadas called Kathopanishad has been given free on platter to anybody who comes to Shruti Mata. Simply for the sake of compassion, she has in her bosom always for the devotees or the sadhaka. So the one who focuses himself on the Kathopanishad is guaranteed to get what he is seeking for. And that is why Gurudeva in the last mantra, 18th mantra's commentary says, free from rajas or sin, free from impurities, free from vice and virtue. This vice and virtue is important. Vidya praptya virajo vigata dharma adharma. Vidya prapto, when you get this vidya. Vidya means the final knowledge of Atma Tattvam. When you get this vidya, vidya prapto virajo goes away dharma adharma. Now this person is not even involved in dharma. Adharma is anyway no question of adharma. he has been a dharmic person so far, and that is why the culminating shloka or mantra of Bhagavad Gita is sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam praja. Sarva dharman, sarva means dharma as well as adharma. To Arjuna, tumne chhodi diya hai, ab dharma kabhi chhodo. Why? Because I am beyond dharma and adharma. Jahan pe dharma ka bhi koi kaam nahi, because dharma is also for the upadhi of jiva. Ab tum jiv nahi rahe, you have transcended the jiva and has become paramatman. Paramatman cannot have any quality or attribute. Dharmic brahman, there is nothing called like that. Brahman is brahman. Brahman is Brahman means what? Attributeless. Attributeless means vigata dharma adharma. That is why free from rajas or sin, free from impurities, free from vice and virtue, the jnana sadhana consisting in controlling the flow of sense organs towards the sense objects by a powerful application of the powers of discrimination and severe mental discipline. I'm repeating Gurudeva's word. Severe mental discipline. When he says severe, that means it is not something that anybody can just think that I will have it just as a standby thing. A sadhana shurasya dhara nishitaya durgam patastata kavayo vadanti. Same Upanishad I is saying, it is like walking on the razor blade. And that means one should be prepared to sacrifice everything that it comes down the way. The mind is thus redeemed in slow and steady stages from a dross of egoistic vanities, self-centered passions and desires, attachments, lusts, greed, and so on. And by employing such controlled and purified mind, see, two words are important, controlled and purified mind. How will you purify your mind unless you control it? Purification is possible when the mind is controlled. Then, once it is controlled and purified mind, it is supposed to dwell at a limited chosen form of idea. Its powers of concentration are developed. Lastly, these newly developed powers of continued concentration are applied with greater intensity, intense heat, for developing deep beneath the delusory five matters of envelopments of spirit to contact the self, which is of the nature of pure consciousness, eternal and absolute. In this paragraph, Gurudev has given his own sadhana, which he did in 7 or 8 lines, but that happens after n number of births, one reaches that stage. That is the reason why Bhagavan in Bhagavad Gita says, Arjuna, one amongst those thousands thinks of me, and yet one amongst us, yatate, one amongst them is able to reach at my place. This is where the Kathopnishad mantra ends, and then the Shanti mantra starts. Om Sahana Vavatu Sahano Vunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvina Vaditamastum Ma Vidvijavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. This again Swamiji has commented upon him, and the comment is on idea of team spirit. He says, what is a team spirit? The one who is teaching, one who is listening, if both of them are coming to the congregation, or if they are meeting with something in their mind which is distinguishing themselves with their egos, the learning can never progress. A teacher, when he is trying to teach, if he feels that the teaching is nothing else but its dharma, and if the student is receiving the knowledge given by the guru or the teacher as something that has come directly from the compassionate Shruti, and it has been a great honor on him to have this particular knowledge at the feet of the guru, then both of them are, they rise high up in their mind to a level where the adana pradana of the vichara that is happening between the two happens at the highest or the ecclesiastical level. The guru has to be put on high pedestal, and the compassion that the guru has about the student or the vidyarthi has to be also at equally high pedestal. And then by sayog, samavaya of these two highly enlightened minds coming together, highly receptive mind of the shishya and highly enlightened mind of the guru coming together with a complete involvement of heart to heart interaction with no ego existing whereupon, and then that particular thing leads to the 100% fruition of what is to be taught. And that is why Om Sahanau Avatu. Sahanau, now is the Dvivachan of Naha. That means we, us, Sahanau Avatu, protect us. It's a prayer, it's a Shanti Mantra prayer. Protect us, both of us. Then may He bless us with bliss of knowledge. Sahano bhunaktu, sahaviryam karvave, let us exert together. Tejas vina vadhitamastu ma vidyushavahe, may what we study by well studied, be well studied, may we not hate or quarrel with each other. Gurudeva says, this is to avoid the useless arguments. There are some people who, instead of focusing at the gist of the matter, are more interested in knowing what is why is why. This is called kutarka and the vitarka. So these are not to be, because life is too short. So we cannot get involved into such useless arguments. And that being the reason, even the Shankaracharya, while commenting on this mantra, he says very clearly, sahanau avam avatu palayatu vidya swarupa prakashanena. What is avatu? What do you mean by protect us? Palayatu vidya swarupa prakashena. Amara humko sambhalo. Please protect us. And what is the best protection in the world? The highest protection, vidya swarupa prakashena. One who has seen atmatattvam, that is the highest protection. Not only he has it for himself, he has for all. Sahanau avam avam avatu palayatu vidya swarupa prakashena. Kaha, how, kon? Sa eva parameshwara upanishad prakashitaha. Acharya is given a bold statement. Parameshwara upanishad prakashita. That means one who is Parameshwara has only given this upanishad for the prakasha. That prakasha of vidya should protect us. Kimcha, moreover, sahano bhunaktu tat phal prakashanena nau palayitu. Bhunaktu tat phal prakashana. After having this Upanishad's gist of knowledge, it will become a fruit for me, which will nourish my spiritual body. Sahe vava vidyakrutam viryam samarthyam karvavahe. Both of us should be very robust with the vidyarupi virya. Virya is something which makes the veer out of it. So both of us shall become veer with through the vidyarupi. Kim cha tejasvinam. Tejasvinaha avayo yad adhitam tat su adhitam astu. Whatever we have learned from the tej of this knowledge, let it be inside our mind in the suvidya rupa susthiti. That vidya should stay with us. There should not be again skhalana. Normally after atma tattva prakashana, there is nothing that one can come down from that state, yet the prayer is still there. Athava tejasvi navavabhya yat adhittat ativa tejasvi viryavat astu. The other meaning of it is, whatever we have learned so far, let that which has been learned be so powerful so that we become ati tejasvi. So we become ati tejasvi. Then ma vidvishavahe. Shishya achari eva anyonya pramada kruta anyaya adhyana adhyapana dosha nimittam dvesham ma karvavahe ityartham. This is very, very critical. And perhaps I will take recourse to this, because during the teaching, there is a possibility that some mistakes. And what is a mistake? Even though your intention is good to teach and good to learn, it is quite possible that because of your level of appreciation of the facts that are being discussed, we may say something which is not perfect. Why so? Because the perfection is only for the Brahmaiva Brahmavid, not with others. So if at all there is something from my side or from the disciple's side. And in that case, that should not become a cause for adhyana, adhyapana dosha nimitta, dvesham ma karvavahe. Please forgive the teacher, please forgive the student, because he, either of them, if at all they have committed, if at all, unintentional, by virtue of the limitation, by virtue of the situational difference, because mistakes are not always created by mind. That is called pramada. In fact, one of the limitations of human mind is pramada. Bhaya pramada vipralipsa karna pato. These are the mano buddhi dosh. Pramada dosh, if at all it has come, being unintentional, there should not be any dvesham ma karvavahe. And if this much is done, then whether it is adhyatmik, adhidaivik, or adhibhautik, all the three shantis will always prevail upon us. And then this three shantis shall be prevailing only when the pranava is associated with it. That means once the Brahman is there, then on all the front, what prevails upon everything is just the shanti. And that is how the shanti mantra ends. With the end of shanti mantra, we also end the Kathopanishad. With Gurudeva's blessings, our own punyai, my own prarabdham, that His grace and His God has allowed us to interact with each other, sing the glory of Shruti Mata through the Kathopanishad for 85 long hours. I might have slipped many a times. I might have not been able to raise myself to the level where I was required. Whenever I was identifying myself with the Gurudeva's blessings, maybe that was the time you all felt that what was told was something exceedingly beautiful. It was all because of the Vahana, and the Vahana was Gurudeva's blessings. At any point of time, if you feel, or you must have felt, that what I said was not up to the mark, then that was the time that the vehicle was absent. It came directly from me. So such an alpadnya, dull-witted manda buddhi, was also given an authority to speak. Shrotaha, those who listen, are Keshava Murti. You all are nothing else but Shiva Swarupa. You all listen to me carefully, intently, giving me the encouragement that was required during this teaching. So with all humility, I bow to you because you gave me an opportunity to speak. There must be a divine plan behind this. Nothing happens without divine plan. So with due respect to all of you, and of course to Gurudeva, we were able to spend some beautiful moments in the glory of Shruti Mata. This could become, and this should become for all of us, a point to start inward journey. All this is said in words, words explaining the words of the Rishis. So this is Shabda Chala. This is a play of words. But what is important is all that is heard by you, all that is heard by me, all that is uttered by me, all that is heard by my ears also, should ultimately result into the practical application of what we have learned. Now we know where we stand. We have at least what is called as paroksha jnanam of Atma Tattvam. We know the kaleidoscope of Shastra in the miniature form. We cannot claim to know everything under the Shastra because it is like a sagara. If Shankaracharya's, Swamiji's or Shankaracharya's knowledge itself, he himself compared to a small fistful of water in the flowing Ganga, then a person like me cannot even claim a microscopic drop of it. But important thing is to take all these thoughts into the mind. Keep thinking about Him. As we keep thinking, we have already entered the territory of mananam. Once the chintan and manana starts, the mind gets habituated to these thoughts. And these thoughts are exclusive
so that all the other thoughts are automatically dropped. Being in the place where you are, being the part of the family life that we all are, we can still be away from the family life, we can still be away from the world and involve ourselves into the continuous manthana of the vichara, which is mananam, about whatever we have learnt. And then one theme that reverberated throughout the Kathopanishada was the control of mind. The whole focus seems to be going through the mind. Every now and then Gurudev talks about the mind, the mantras speak about the mind. So all that we need to do is controlling the mind. When we observe the mind, we realize that it has very, very mundane kind of attractions. And here the talk is about raising the mind to the level of to grapple the Atma Tattva. So the beginning has to be from the mundane things. As Shivananda Maharaj always says, start from the smallest thing that you see in front of you. The unnecessary bouts of anger that we get, the unnecessary bouts of tendency to eat, tendency to move around, tendency to rajoguna, always throbbing in the heart of ours, we need to really calm it down. And the calming would mean that you become a calming personality. Let the mind come to you and ask, hey master, can I do this? That is what mind control is all about. When we get dragged by the mind into different things on their daily life, that is when the mind conquers us. And with the mind that has conquered us, we cannot conquer the mind. Without conquering the mind and controlling the mind and directing it, as Gurudeva says, control it first, direct it later, and again put it for intense and severe penances further. That being the process, the first important thing is to control the mind. And then another thing, whatever we learn early in the wee mornings, all these 85 classes that we had, our chitta vritti becomes ullasita because the vichari in our mind is of only Kathopanishad. But moment sthala kala tyaga is there, moment it is 7 o'clock, we all forget what we have done. And that is what the trickery or the treachery of mind is. Need to tell the mind that, look, I'm going to focus on what I have learnt. And when we constantly struggle with our mind to control the mind and yet be a part of what is happening in the daily life, that is precisely the balance between the grihasthashrama and the internal sannyasashrama that we are opting for. And this struggle is called vanaprasthashrama. This is preparatory stage. So we have a dais open for us for the preparatory phase. For all the time in the day and the night, try to be as much in solitude as possible. Be away from the world, be away from this hunger for knowledge, be away from the ichcha that we have that I would like to become a better speaker of spirituality. It is not the intention to become a better speaker. It is not the intention to get the accolades from everyone that you are the best speaker of the spirituality. It is not to get the pat on the back that look how studied you are. All these are absolutely thoroughly useless, guttery things, because this has nothing to do with spirituality. Spirituality is being alone, being in solitude, being with God, and being in the full control of the mind, being in the realm where only you and you are existing, because you are Brahman. Brahman is only one, and when in the realm of Brahman, there is no sukham, there is no dukkham, kevala kevala sat chit ananda. Hari Om.
Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Udachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Hari Om. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om. We requested Sanjay ji in April 2018 to take one Upanishad class, and it today again we are on another April 2020, and in this really it is a don't know how to what words to say, because Gurudev is so benevolent. Gurudev has sent a person like Sanjay ji to explain Upanishad in this depth, at his depth, but as a person amongst us. So this is something really, I mean, if you go and sit probably, I mean, when visiting Swamiji's are coming also, we will not feel that closeness. But Sanjay ji is like amongst us, but yet at the level of Gurudev. So we are really blessed. Thank you, Sanjay.
Thank you.